Welcome to part one of a series that I'm making on Jehovah's Witnesses and how they fall under the BITE model. The BITE model is a model used to describe how a cult or a religion, high control group, whatever you want to call it, uses certain ways to recruit and keep control of the members, of the people in it. So we're going to see how Jehovah's Witnesses really perfectly, almost point by point, fall under this model. So this one, we're going to do B, which stands for behavior. The I stands for information control. T stands for thought control. And E stands for emotional control. But today, we're only going to do behavior control. Jehovah's Witnesses, they're mostly known for being friendly people who knock on your door, try to invite people into, you know, join their meetings, start a Bible study. They'll say they're just trying to encourage people. But they don't know is that it's a lot more nefarious than what it appears, because the leadership definitely does of Jehovah's Witnesses have a tight control of what they can and can't do according to the behavior. So in all transparency, a lot of these points that we're getting is from freedomofmind.com, but I mean, in reality, this is just things that Jehovah's Witnesses can tell you. It is very true. So they can dictate where and who and with whom they live with and associate with. We know that Jehovah's Witnesses are discouraged to associate with what they consider bad association. And bad association is really open. It can be anybody from somebody who's a weak witness or somebody who's a witness who's not very in, you know, who maybe didn't report any hours. That person already could be considered bad association. All the way up to somebody who's like not a witness to begin with. A co-worker could be considered bad association. I know that when I was a witness, I was criticized by elders for hanging out with people who weren't witnesses. And that's not just an isolated incident, like my congregation was strict. No, that's a pretty common thing. So they dictate who you can't and be friends with, basically. They control your types of clothing and hairstyles. We know that witnesses, you know, they don't let witnesses to have long hair. Men will have long hair. And, you know, women to have different certain types of hair colors, they discourage. They won't outright tell you, okay, a woman, a sister, cannot have, let's say, blue hair. But if a sister has blue hair, do you think that they're going to give them an assignment on the platform to give during a midweek meeting? No. So, again, they don't flat out tell you. But it is something that has become a part of the norm of the culture. And it's seen as such up to where, like, even though maybe their shepherding book or some information that an elder has, you know, doesn't say that specific thing, they will still use Bible principles to counsel a brother or sister, you know, even if it's not flat out said in the watchtower. And that's everywhere in the organization. For example, beards. Witnesses in North America have a very corporate America look. Witnesses in general have a very corporate America feel. So, you know, they wear like business attire, suit, tie, plain colors, typically, you know, white, light blue. You know, maybe an eccentric brother will wear like a pink or something like that, a purple shirt, but typically it's very neutral colors. And they'll have, you know, a clean-shaven face. Yeah, you will never, almost never see a brother with a beard. And if you do, it's a very liberal congregation out like somewhere in California or something, or somewhere where there's a lot of Middle Eastern folk. But you will almost never see a brother with a full-on beard. And they'll say it's because it's a worldly look. Or they'll say it's because it's not, it's something seen as worldly in your area. In reality, depending where you're at, it has nothing to do with the Bible. The scripture is something that is God inspired. It doesn't change based off its location. Scripture is scripture, comes from God, right? So Leviticus 19, one thing witnesses can have, I forgot to mention, is tattoos. That's a no-no. If you're a witness and you get a tattoo, and the elders find out you have a tattoo, you can get in serious trouble, as in disfellowshipping, if you're not repentant, or if you're repentant and they deem you non-repentant, or, you know, at least like a public reproval, as far as I know. That's an offense. Well, they'll use the scripture, Leviticus 19. 28. And it says there, in their translation, the New World Translation, you must not make cuts in your flesh for a dead person, and you must not make tattoo markings on yourself. I am Jehovah. Okay. You must not make tattoo markings. They'll say, okay, so obviously, you know, this is the law of the Israelites, Leviticus 19, right? So you must not do this. Look at what it says in 27. Okay, verse 27 of that same chapter. You must not shave the hair on the side of your head or disfigure the edges of your beard. So literally, don't shave and don't cut your hair. Like, okay, so is that not part of what we do? So we do one part of this text, but literally the text right before we don't do, you see? So witnesses, they'll cherry pick scripture, but they won't look at the whole context. Literally right there says, don't shave your beard. So again, you know, it's all about the control and the look. If everybody looks the same, if everybody acts the same, people, it's easier to control people. Okay, so they control hairstyles, clothing, yes. They restrict your leisure, entertainment, and vacation time. Very true. If you're a witness on vacation, you're typically expected, it's not said, but you're expected to go to your local meeting in that area. I remember going to Florida. We would look up, like, where's the local hall, and we might go there. You know, and, you know, if there's somebody in the ministry, if you're out and there's somebody talking about something, you can even witness to them and put it in your hours. So they always have a hold on you. They would say you're a witness 24/7, no matter what. And that included all the witness things like preaching and meetings. Control major time spent with group indoctrination and rituals and or self indoctrination, including the internet. Very true. One of the few websites that JW.org will ever talk about is themselves, JW.org, the witnesses. You know, they spend all this time, Wednesday meetings or midweek meetings, your Sunday meetings, the ministry, which has a meeting before, you know, the field service. So all these things are so that self-indoctrination, not including your own personal study that you would have. All these things add up. Thoughts, feelings, and activities of others and reported to superiors. Witnesses are known to be snitches. Witnesses are known to be, you know, to snitch on each other. You tell the elders, oh, I saw this brother do that. And you post one thing on the internet, bam, goes straight to the elders. Word spreads like wildfire in witness circles, trust me. So this snitching and stuff is a way they control behavior, and it's something that is encouraged in their own literature too. Rewards and punishments used to modify behaviors, both positive and negative. They discourage individualism and encourage groupthink. Very true. Read any of their watchtowers for the past, you know, long time. They say, isn't this what we believe? Aren't we so glad that Jehovah did this? How happy are we that the governing body did this? You see, all this us, we, that is inclusive speech. That is stuff that makes us feel part of a group. And of course, you know, we fall under whatever they're trying to teach us. They encourage and engage in corporal punishment. Although the leadership doesn't do that necessarily, that's something that they do say, you know, the rod. So they in a way, encourage corporal punishment when it comes to parents in their children. And instill dependency and obedience. Very true, because think about it. If you, as a witness, are encouraged to only have witness friends, to surround yourself with witnesses, you're going to be in an echo chamber of just JW beliefs and JW things. So when you do a mistake and the elders find out, because everybody's a snitch, then everybody turns their back on you. And if you're disfellowshipped, no one's going to talk to you. And all your circles are completely gone. And you're not going to talk to other people who aren't witnesses because you're taught their bad association. So in reality, witnesses, they really control. They have a tight control on their members. And they fit really snug into this BITE model, especially under the B for behavior control. So next time we'll talk about information control.